Debanjali?
Yes, ma'am.
10:05, which means it's 10:03. Another 2 minutes and we'll start, right?
Yes, ma'am. Kavita has joined.
Yeah.
Good morning, ma'am.
Satyam, where are your other classmates? Ask them to join. I can see some.
Ma'am, I think most of there, ma'am, in conference, I see.
Okay, Devanjali, start.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the second day of the Young Researchers Conference on Immigration in Europe, Trends, Shifts, and Perspectives. Our first working session for today is Refugee Crisis and EU Member States Responses. With that, I would like to request Dr. Shakti Prasad Srichandan, Assistant Professor at the Center for European Studies in the School of International Studies, JEDU, to chair the session. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Devanjali, and good morning to all of you. Welcome to working session 5 of day 2 of this Young Scholars Conference. Today's theme is, the theme of this session is Refugee Crisis and EU Member States Responses. So talking about refugee crisis, refugee as an issue is not something new to Europe. Europe has long been a destination for refugee flows from various countries, especially from North African region. As early as in 1992, the then UN High Commissioner for Refugees, Sadaka Ogata, voiced her concern about the future of refugee protection. She said, and I quote, "As we move into 1990s, there is no doubt that Europe is at a crossroads. Will Europe turn its back on those who are forced to move, or will it strengthen its long tradition of safeguarding the rights of the oppressed and the uprooted? Will Europe build new walls, knowing that walls did not stop those who were fleeing totalitarian persecution in the past?" So what changed between the refugee as an issue in at the end of the last century and at the beginning of this century? What changed the situation? The change, basically nothing changed in the approach. Europe was unprepared at that time. Europe was also not prepared during the last decade when the refugee became a crisis. Refugee issue was an administrative and political issue in the last century, but it became a crisis in the last decade when after Syrian crisis, Syrian war, civil war in Syria, and on the political unrest in Iraq and other regions. So basically the change is the geographical location. In the last century, North Africa was the scene. Now Middle East has joined the scene. So in total, the MENA region has become the scene and the major migrants, refugee sending regions for the EU. So basically, why it became a crisis? My understanding is that there are two reasons. First is migration was an administrative issue during the last century, but the scale and diversity of refugees changed the discourse. In past, it was the persecution or the environment migrants like that, but the scale and diversity of refugees have changed during the last decade. And secondly, the preparedness or the migration management at the EU level. His Excellency Ambassador of European Union yesterday, he was very honest enough to admit that when it comes to migration management, EU is still at a very young stage. And also Professor Sajdava rightly pointed out that when the member states, they are not willing to share or give away their competences when it comes to migration issues. Both these factors played a role in making migration a crisis, the refugee as a crisis at the EU level in the last decade, starting from 2015. It was not that before 2015, refugees were not there. Even after civil war in 2011, which started in Syria, there were refugee flows. Even 2014-13, there were refugee flows. But it became a crisis when the European Union and its member states, they could not able to manage it. So these both these regions played a major role in making refugee a crisis. The refugee crisis that has struck the European Union in the last decade was massive in scale and unparalleled in its known history. This crisis not only posed the toughest challenge for EU to safeguard its international obligation and commitments, but also tested the institutional, legal, and values and ideals on which the EU stands as it is today. So many EU countries were either unprepared or unwilling to cope with the scale and diversity of refugees. So against this backdrop, our current session is very relevant, as our young scholars will present their papers on how some member states and domestic socio-political discourse responded to the crisis or made it worse. So we have 6 papers, and as you know, we are giving you 10 minutes to complete your presentation. Our first speaker is Mr. Manoranjan Kumar. He's a research scholar at Center for European Studies, and he will be presenting on European refugee crisis of 2015 and the response of Hungary. So Manoranjan, the floor is yours.
Hello, good morning, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay. Thank you. I am going to present my paper on a refugee crisis of 2015 and the response of Hungary. As we know that the first two decades of the 21st century has witnessed so many conflicts and violence caused by the civil war in different parts of the world. And these conflicts have compelled the people of this region to leave their homes and displaced towards the safer region of the world. The refugee crisis of 2015 was such an example, where the people from the conflict zones, mainly Syrian, Iraqis, and Afghans, migrate to protect their lives. In 2015, more than 1 million migrants crossed the Mediterranean Sea illegally by boats with the help of smugglers and arrived in the European countries like Italy and Greece. And at this level, but the sudden influx of this but the sudden influx of so many people at the large scale create a situation that is like crisis. So it's called a European migration crisis. Now I'm going to talking about the response of Hungary towards this crisis. Actually, when the so many people from Syria or war-torn countries come to Europe, they wanted to go to northern side of Europe, like countries like Germany or Sweden, etc. They do not want to live in countries like Italy or Greece or Hungary or any other countries. But the response of Hungarian government was not so welcoming, and the Prime Minister of Hungary announced that these arrival of asylum seekers or refugees are not come on the humanitarian ground, but they are come as a threat. They perceive this crisis as a threat to security of the European identity and values. The Hungarian government has adopted so many anti-immigrant rules in order to contain the unprecedented number of refugees. The first step was they have decided to build a reservoir fence along its border with Serbia and Croatia. In 2015 September, they completed their fence, and they allowed migrants only through two transit zones. Actually, they made two transit zones to come to the territory of Hungary, and this was not sufficient for at that moment. Actually, to understand the response of the Hungary towards refugee crisis, it's important to understand the domestic politics of Hungary. In the early 2015, the ruling party Fidesz began to slipping in the polls. The party has been hit by a series of corruption scandals and had made unpopular decisions, sparking large demonstrations in the Hungary. So they wanted to
Yes, Manoranjan, continue. They wanted to deviate the attention, right?
Attention from these domestic policies to from their citizens. So when this crisis started, they portrayed these immigrants as intruders in Europe. They started many types of propaganda about migrants, and they also instructed their media houses to portray only the bad image of migrants, not the images of children or women of the refugees. Then it's all when the when in 2016 the deal between EU and Turkey stopped the flow of migrations, then EU decided to relocate the refugees of refugees who were stranded in the Italy and Greece, and the EU decided to relocate them in the EU member states, and EU asked Hungary to adopt only 1,294 refugees, but the Hungarian government rejected that idea, and they called, "We are not going to adopt any refugees." Hungarian Prime Minister stand was very clear. He told, "We may lose our European values, our very identity by degrees, like the live frog allowing itself to be slowly cooked to death in the pan of water." So basically, he was not accepting these migrants. His statement quoted that the migration problem is only Germany's problem, because all the migrants want to go to Germany, not they are live in other European countries. And in other anti-immigrant policies, Hungary made a policy, Hungary amended its criminal code, which criminalize who enter Hungary through unauthorized way. So
Manojan, you may conclude in 2 minutes. You have 2 minutes left.
Okay, sir. So basically, the response of Hungary towards the immigration, towards the immigrant crisis, was not so welcoming. And the role of civil society in the Hungary was very encouraging, as they provide food, water, and all amenities, all basic amenities to the refugees. But their government has done nothing. They only spend millions of euros on building their fences and strengthen their border security, but they spend a minimal amount of their money on the refugee or this crisis, and they don't want to accept any Muslim refugees in particular, because during the Yugoslavia war, the Hungarian government adopted so many Bosnian Muslims, but now this time they had adopted the different policies. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Manoranjan. Just to add, in 2017, European Commission, in 2017, European Commission dragged Hungary, Poland, and Czech Republic to the Court of European Court of Justice for rejecting the plan of quota system. And in 2020, the decision is still pending, but the European Commission is pressing hard to impose sanctions or fines against Hungary for not following that quota system. But interesting fact is that Hungary has been dragged to court for not following that quota system, but those countries, those who agreed to admit their quota of refugees in their country, they did not even admit half of what they promised. So this is very interesting. Okay, now our next speaker is Pooja. She is a research scholar at Center for European Studies, and she will be speaking on state of Islamophobia in France. Pooja, your floor is yours.
Okay, so very good morning to all of you. The title of my topic is the state of Islamophobia in France. Basically, I will cover a few points. The first is, what is Islamophobia? Then what are the deriving forces of Islamophobia? And how the Islamophobia constitute a challenges to European democracy? Then Islamophobia in France, focusing on some case reports and incidents. Then impact of Islamophobia on the people of France. Then recent issues regarding the Islamophobia in France territory. Then role of media to create public image about the Islam and its fear. And then I'll conclude my paper. So I'll start from the definition of Islamophobia. In a very simple term, we can say that Islamophobia is the fear of Islam, hatred of or prejudice against the Islamic religion or Muslims after the many attacks of many countries. Basically, it is considered as the fear of terror attack, which are mostly founded, rooted in the Islamic states. And this continues to be debated, what is behind of this fear is religion or any particular community. So many scholars define in many ways. Some scholars considered Islamophobia is a form of racism, and some other scholars considered Islamophobia and racism is partially overlapping phenomena. And many scholars analyze increase in Islamophobia just because of increased presence of Muslim in the EU and US. And fear of Islam, we can understand that the previous attack, like 9/11 US attack on French soldiers in 2012, and in 2015, attack on France, Italy, and Germany, and 2019, attack on Kenya, Philippines, and many more. And one of report, European Islamophobia report, it is provided a unique collection in regarding the anti-Muslim racism in Europe. So according to them, monitoring of Islamophobia in Europe became an urgent need following the economic recession and rise of far-right politics. Now the deriving forces of Islamophobia, basically fear, ignorance, and geopolitical climate are the deriving forces of Islamophobia. And Islamophobia constitute a serious challenges to European democracy. Basically, it is impacting the life of million of Muslims. They are facing racism at the university, in the workplace, in the public sphere. And this racism undermines their space in society and their sense of belonging to the European nation states. And Islamophobia poses a problem of internal security, intensifies between communities, legitimize hate crimes against individual, and undermine the European ideals of peace and coexistence, and challenge the EU image of tolerance and welcoming immigration and threat to European democracy. And many intellectuals and politicians, both left and right wing, they are denying the existence of this concept because they are worrying about the terrorist attack and immigration are preventing them from acknowledging the daily racism that Muslims face in Europe. One of community, the Maghreb community, they has a strong feeling of they are not belonging and conflict of no identity. Now the Islamophobia in France, focusing on some case reports and incident. Basically, France had a hostile attitudes towards Muslim and Islam since the first headscarf cases started in 1989. One of Abdullahjee Chambis, he's from the group of coordination against racism and Islamophobia, CRI group. He said that when France was colonial master, they occupy many of Muslim land in Africa and Middle East. And Algeria, one of the French colonial territory, integrated as a constituent part of country, but they don't have citizenship right. And French said that they are too much attached to their religion and not fit in the ideology built on separation of state and church. And sometimes for civil campaign urging women to unveil relegation of Arabic language from private sphere. This shows the French reputation of police brutality, labor discrimination, and hate crimes against mainly Muslims, Arab, and African migrants. And according to French Council of Muslim Faith, 110 Islamophobic attack and threat happened in the first 9 months of 2014 and 158 in 2013. This is only registered complaint. There are many more complaints that is not registered. And one of survey, Pew survey happened in 2008. In this survey, 754 people giving views on various religious group. Out of 754, 38% are very unfavorable opinion regarding the Muslim. And another Pew survey happened in 2014. 2014. In this survey, 1,003 people giving views on various diseases group living in France. Out of 1,003, 27% are very unfavorable opinion regarding the Muslim. And some respondents said that Islam is an intolerant religion and not incompatible within the value of French society. Now, the impact of Islamophobia on the people of France. The first is a wastage of resource and loss of opportunity. Like many of civil society organization and political organization take initiative to counter Islamophobia, but there is lack of coherence, unity, integration, and coordination. It is wasted of resource and loss of opportunity. And it's create permanent climate of hate against Muslim. Situation became rhetoric and violent, growing anti-Muslim sentiments and violence against female, like attack on female candidates who is wearing headscarf, increased racism and repression, and increased new kind of terrorism. For example, in 2015, jihadist attack on France, 300 people were killed. The attackers have been local, but they received their ideological instruction and practical support from the Islamic states. So it's a new wave of terrorism because terror who are spreading, they are French-born citizen. So now the recent issues regarding the Islamophobia in French territory, there are many issues, but I will focusing only one or two because of lack of time. So the first is in May 2019, there was serious attack in France that related to the terror. Then French police arrested a 24-year-old Algerian computer student suspected of planting a bomb in Lyon. And the another issue is that a man named Michael Harpoon worked at Paris police headquarters. He stabbed four of his colleagues to death just because of different ideological views. They are killing the people. And even another recent issues in October 2020, a French teacher killed by an 18-year-old Chechen origin boy. After the murder of French teacher, the country's government announced the anti-Muslim bill. So these are the recent issues regarding the Islamophobia in French territory. Now the role of media to create public image about the Islam and its fear. Basically, media stigmatize the Muslim population to link with terror and cover Muslim-related issues in very negative light. In the film industries also, Muslims are associated with terrorism and portrayed in many films only further the stereotype that Muslims. And 9/11 terrorist attack drastically changed public opinion towards Muslim. Overall, we can say media created negative image of Muslim. So in my conclusion part, there is no consensus among scholars regarding the concept of Islamophobia, but it is important to know because the phenomena is spreading all over the world. It is happening because they face discrimination in employment, education, workplace, and health services, and they face exclusion from government and politics, and prejudice by the media in everyday conversation. So to resolve them, Muslims should become an actor in French political arena. With the organization, they have 2,500 mosques, 1,000 of association, and 6 to 7 million people. So they must take a stand against radicalization, extremism, and terrorism, and they must do a lot of teaching what Islam really is. Thank you.
Thank you, Pooja. You still had 2 minutes left, but thank you for your nice presentation. Just to add, in France, there is a system called laïcité, the French laïcité, which is kind of secularism in French. France, though it was made to, it was both a cultural, you can say, cultural ideology and a policy framework to separate religion from government. But nowadays it has been used against the Muslim community to isolate them and to create an image that Islam is not in sync with European values. Thank you for your presentation. Our next speaker is Lemi Saikias. He's a research scholar at Center for European Studies. And she will be speaking on analyzing the anti-immigration narrative in Poland under the law and justice government. Over to you, Alemi. You have 10 minutes.
Thank you so much, sir. As sir already said, my topic is analyzing the anti-immigration narrative in Poland, especially under the government of the Law and Justice Party. I would be exploring basically three important themes in the course of my presentation. The first obvious theme is what sort of a narrative and response have been made by Poland with respect to the developments of 2015 in terms of the influx of refugees that came in from the South European border. The second has been how the narratives have been skewed in the favor of the governing Law and Justice Party to suit their nationalist rhetorics, as well as an Islamophobic rhetoric that has also been furthered across the election campaign, as well as for the years after they came in power. And finally, what this entire situation in Poland, the reaction of the people, the reaction of the government, what does this have to say about state and the kind of challenges that the modern state faces in light of the crisis that happened in 2015? So the 2015 refugee crisis left a mark across Europe for various reasons, of course. Reactions in about the incoming refugees from the South European border could be geographically divided in a way that the West was willing to accept them, whereas the Central and Eastern Europe was not ready to share their burden. With respect to Poland, the Republic of Poland was conceived under circumstances that had lived through a history of annexation and capture by hostile neighbors. It is impossible to imagine that the present day country that Poland is had once a fragile structure that made it easy target for ambitious powers across the European continent. While present day Poland seems to be flourishing very well economically, with its GDP as of 2009 being amongst the top 20 countries in the world, politically Poland has seen several cascading developments over the recent years, especially after the Law and Justice Party came to power in 2015, and most especially on several issues that that conflate on issues like nationalism and on the recent issues of abortion rights. Now, for the sake of this paper, we would be highlighting on what Poland's response was from 2015 with regard to the influx of refugees that came in to the European continent. In September 2015, Poland held parliamentary elections, which was won by the Law and Justice Party. For the first time since 1989, one party obtained an absolute majority of seats, allowing it to form a government on its own. The new government appointed in November, which is just a few months after Merkel talked about how she's ready to accept and how Europe should be ready to accept refugees. This new government, during their election campaign, evoked fear of refugees, and the government's official position, however, initially seemed not to differ much from the previous government. However, they would, in the years and months following that, would aggressively campaign against any of those Muslim immigrants or refugees, both of the terms which they used to confuse with one another very frequently, that Poland is not welcome to either of them. Probably the very fact that they were part of the European Union initially made it impossible for them to block or evade any policies or decisions that were made for this in the case of this crisis. But considering that the Law and Justice government won an absolute majority, validating their negative campaign of 2015 against Merkel's declaration of accepting the refugees, they bluntly and openly rejected to take in any refugees thereafter. However, at the beginning of 2016, the government prepared a draft regulation on the reception of refugees. The draft envisioned that Poland would take only 400 refugees by the end of 2016, which clearly showed government unwilling to fulfill EU commitments. The following months brought about a tightening of the government's position and Poland and other countries of the V4, the Visegrad 4, issued a joint declaration that expressed a negative stance on the relocation program. After the terrorist attack in Brussels in March 2016, one of the Law and Justice representatives, Cizio, openly declared in an interview that I do not see how Poland could take on any immigrants in the present circumstances. The right-wing politicians who dominated this entire public discourse have identified migrants and refugees as mostly Muslims who were a national threat. The problem wasn't with the fact that they could be economic migrants, that they could be immigrants, or they could be refugees. The problem was with the fact that the whole idea of this community being culturally different from the majority community of Poland could be disastrous for their country. On the economic front, they did not really press on how this could affect them economically. Considering Poland was doing well economically, there were a few flippant dismissive comments about how the low-paying jobs would be taken by Muslims and how that would affect, you know, the cultural social fabric. But more often than not, the law and justice representatives often focus on how the social fabric of Poland would be affected, and that after effects of that would be far more dangerous than any economic after effects. Polish Islamophobia is also somewhere connected to contemporary anti-Semitism by the fact that both of these hated groups are almost absent from Poland. It is important to acknowledge at this point that Poland, despite having the presence of certain minority groups like Christian Ukrainians who have migrated from Ukraine, or even Muslims and other minority groups, it is a substantially homogeneous country. This can be due to different developments in history, of course, but the one that's oftenly linked to this phenomenon is the fact that there was an expulsion and anti-Semitic practices during the war. According to estimates, there are approximately 35,000 Muslims living in Poland, which is approximately 0.1% of the population. And the Muslim population is also a result of the migration from socialist Arab countries during the communist era, as well as the post-in 1989 migration connected with incorporating Poland into the global economy. But the very fact that Poland could, the fact that the Poland could become a transit route for most of this influx of refugees was something that was considered heavily problematic by the Law and Justice Party, regardless of the fact that the refugees did not consider Poland as the ideal destination or an ideal transit country in the first place. The previous government before, like, the Law and Justice came to power, had raised doubts about how these refugees would make it impossible for them to separate between refugees and economic migrants, which they are okay with. But PIS, or the Law and Justice Party, radicalized these doubts by stating that majority of the refugees were economic migrants. And in this discourse, the category of economic migrant has been taken on very unambiguously negative meaning. It is someone who wants to take away the welfare benefits that are being given by the government. In fact, one of the PIS politicians, Patrick Jaki, said that 90% of these so-called immigrants, 90% of the so-called immigrants do not even want to work. In this context, Law and Justice politicians refer to ethnic particularism and ethnic concept of nation. They emphasize that Poland should first help ethnic Poles resettle from the effects of the World War II and 1989, who want to repatriate to Poland. Now, shortly after New Year's Eve in Cologne, the cover of the right-wing weekly WCK depicted a white woman screaming and naked and wrapped in the EU flag, with dark hands holding her hands and hair and tearing off the flag. The cover title read, "Islamic Rape of Europe," as Narkowitz notes that this echoed narratives of a threat to white women posed by dangerous brown women. In the right-wing press in Poland, refugees were portrayed as male invaders, terrorists, rapists, and economic migrants who are at war against a European civilization. It is also important to discuss at this point the position of the Catholic Church. Analysis have shown that the message of the Polish Catholic Church were very ambivalent. On the one hand, the leaders talked about how, you know, we should help with the suffering of the refugees, and they must be helped because, you know, the principles of Christian mercy are also important. But on the other hand, they also implicitly evoked an image of religiously other refugee who poses a terrorist threat. Now, when we bring this entire situation under the works of Paul Chilton's proximization theory, it's very easy to see how there has been a symbolic differentiation of us and of them.
Let me, you may continue in 1 minute.
Yeah, it's been very easy to portray the Polish natives as us, and for any immigrants, refugees, especially of Muslim origin, to be portrayed as them. Globalization as a reality is being unusually opposed and fought back with the narratives that are being advocated by leaders who support nationalist rhetorics. It is assumed by many leaders that it is easy to close the tap by physically sealing borders if that fails, by sociopolitically reducing the spaces that immigrants and refugees are welcome to. From the perspective of how Freedom House also describes the global decline of democratic norms over the last 15 years, the development in this regard, especially to this 2015 issue, is probably too early to judge. However, in many ways, this entire issue has been litmus test for the whole of Europe. The very fact that this is considered a crisis specifically for Europe because of the kind of effects it had in Europe has a lot to say about how much there is a concern about the refugees or rather concern about Europe in general. This entire situation has said a lot about statehood, the challenges of modern state faces, and what occurs on ground when you take a step back from merely incorporating principles and values. So in this way, I'd like to conclude that despite all of the issues that have gone on ground, Poland has been advocating a principle Islamophobia for the sake of nationhood, for the sake of nationalism, and at that with that, I'd like to conclude.
Okay, thank you, Limi, for your nice presentation. Just to add, the Polish leadership at that time, they said that they cannot accommodate more refugees when this quota system was put forth. They said that they cannot accommodate more refugees because they had at that time the Ukrainian migrants. But the Ukrainian ambassador to Poland, he said that the Ukrainians, they are not exactly refugees, rather they are, economic migrants, and they are for a temporary period because domestic unrest at that time in Poland. So this is just addition to your, whatever you presented. Our next speaker is Anshu Rawat. She's a research scholar at Center for European Studies. And she will be presenting on politics and migration, the emergence of immigration policies in Spain. Anshu, over to you.
Yes, sir. Good morning, teachers and friends. So as sir has rightly said, the title of my presentation is Politics and Migration, the Emergence of Immigration Policies in Spain. So over the leaky boundaries of man-made states, how many clouds float past them with impunity? How many desert sand shifts from one sand to another? How many mountain pebbles tumble onto foreign soil in provocative hops? Among the innumerable insects, I'll single out only the ant between the border guard's left and right foot, literally ignoring the question, from where and where to? These lines by the poet Wilslowa Szymborska makes one ponder that what is an area if not lines drawn on a map? In this area's mobility, control of national borders not only reflects the ideology of a state, but also creates insiders and outsiders. Immigration policy then is essentially concerned with governing those who have access to the nation's citizenship, non-nation's rights within the nation state, and more importantly, defining policies for those who want to enter it. It makes a nation exclusive. These boundaries of inclusion and exclusion are not fixed. They shift and incorporate the changing geographical borders and social hierarchies that privilege certain groups over the others. There are two ways to analyze migration. First, as an independent variable that provides an explanation for the social political change occurring in Europe. This understanding sees migration as a challenge to governance, order, and states' authority. The second way to analyze it is by focusing on how European countries and the changing dynamics between them produce and shape the understanding of migration. From this vantage point, migration becomes a dependent variable which gains meaning when it interacts with territorial border, such as air, land routes, organizations such as labor markets, and conceptual borders of idea of belonging and membership. Here, the changes in policies and responses to migration are shaped by the worldviews of these organizations in destination countries. These shapes the perception of and responses to migration. Thus, it is the borders of states that makes international migration visible. When analyzing Spain, it can be seen that there's a contradiction in the political economy. Cheap labor is utilized and at the same time marginalized, creating powerful economies of alterite, that is otherness, that is supported by the legal system. Law plays a crucial role in this paradox by interacting with the economy, race, and exclusion. Ironically, this exclusion of immigrants is beneficial for the economies, as immigrants have no rights, avail no benefits from the government, are willing to work by willingly or by compulsion, long hours, low wages and conditions that locals shun. At the same time, these immigrants are stamped as illegal, poor, their difference is highlighted, posing them as suspect population, leading to backlash against them. Thus, the immigration law constructs illegality and also designs policies to integrate them. Informality is not created by migration. It is a barter between the low cost for employers who avoid taxes and social benefits of immigrants who earn more than they could have in their native country. This is aided by weak workplace inspection laws and a difficulty in regulating these sectors. To perceive immigration as an external threat that overshadows the role of labor market and the historical linkages these countries have with the destination nations. Spain has historically been a country of emigration. It was at the end of 1980s that economic boom and the demand for low-skilled labor transformed Spain into a migrant-attracting nation. Economic growth and entry into the European community led to a substantial increase in the last decades of the 20th century. The emergence of immigration policies in the 1980s coincided with economic boom, increase in demand for low-skilled labor, causing an increase in immigrants. But the first immigration law, that is Law 7/1985, aimed at increasing the government's power to deal with aliens already present in the country. And this law was entirely due to the European community's pressure and Spain's obligation to comply with EC's regulation in order to join the economic community. And it did not have to do anything with migration. The passing of the second organic law, 4/2000, and the third organic law, that is 8/2000, saw two very important incidents that led to public opinion and political change. The El Ejido riots in 2000 and the 2001 Lorca incident. In 2000, a small Andalusian town of El Ejido saw the outburst of riots due to the rumor that a mentally ill Moroccan immigrant had stabbed a Spanish woman to death. This led to 2 days of rioting, burning immigrants' homes, their shops and other things into ashes. But the government did not respond. It was completely passive. And for the first time in the history of Spain, immigrants led to strikes. But however, there was no such impact of this strike. In the 2001 incident was a van was carrying 12 Ecuadorian immigrants, but it was crashed by a train and all the 12 immigrants, Ecuadorian immigrants died. So what happened after that was a regularization program was installed in 2001, in which around 24,000 Ecuadorian immigrants were legalized. The second organic law, 4/2000, was initiated by a socialist government, which was in opposition at that time, and was approved just before the general elections, in which the Popular Party, which is the Conservative Party, won. The new law was a positive turning point as it aimed to change the constrictive immigration policies, which had been followed since 17 years. The most remarkable aspect of this law was that it expanded rights to illegal immigrants. It stated that irregular residence and irregular work does not constitute reasons for expulsion. It gave illegal immigrants the freedom to meet, demonstrate, form associations, and freedom to join trade unions, the right to basic free education, the right to emergency healthcare, and the right to public healthcare for minors and pregnant women. Moreover, aliens who were registered in the municipal census also had the right to healthcare at any point of time. The right to assistance of lawyer in cases of forcible deportation, if they were not allowed entry or asylum. And if these immigrants were enrolled in the municipal census and did not have any funds, they had the right to free legal assistance also. The only freedom that they did not have, the illegal immigrants did not have, were right to freedom of movement in Spanish territory, right to vote in municipal elections, right to work to receive facilities of social service, just like the Spaniards, and the right to family reunion. However, the law never had a regulation, thus it did not have any political implementation. So it was just a paper tiger, but it was way ahead of its time. Sorry. The third immigration law, that was Law 8/2000. Same.
1-2 minutes.
Yes, sir. I'll just wrap it up. Don't worry. The third immigration law, 8/2000, came at a time of political change as the Conservative Party, People's Party, won elections. So this law overturned the 4/2000 law and all the rights of the illegal immigrants was taken. The only new thing was that it encouraged the integration of resident foreigners. The fourth organic law, 11/2003, was populist in nature and created multiple possibilities for expulsion of immigrants the last law, that is 14/2003, reformed again the 4/2000 law and made border security concrete rules and sanctions, again stricter rules for all the immigrants. To conclude, Spain is regarded as a frontier nation due to its proximity to major sending countries like Northern Africa and Middle East. Images of immigrants on boats arriving on the shores or those climbing the fences of Ceuta and Melilla reflects two ideas. First, that the nations are under attack by immigrants and gangs that facilitate their movements. And secondly, that the southern borders are porous and a route to the rest of Europe. This understanding fails to consider the desperation of immigrants that take such journeys and the high rate of death that follows these journeys. Considering these, European borders seem airtight and exclusionary. Migration policies of Spain highlights the intricate relationship between economy, political ideology, leading to policy developments. Informality indicates the importance of market, social factors, and limits to control. Lack of regulatory guidelines in Spain highlights a lack of political consensus on immigration matter. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ansu. You have rightly pointed out that El Ejido incident that changed the way the Spanish government and people, they looked upon migrants. So the El Ejido issue also led to politicization and securitization of migration issues and changed the way Spain has been dealing with migrants, refugees since then. Thank you so much, Ansu. Our next speaker is Nikhil Sehra. He's a research scholar at Center for European Studies, and he'll be speaking on transnational populism against immigrants, the altering path of EU values. Over to you, Nikhil.
Thank you, Chair.
Just a minute, I'll take a second to acknowledge Professor Patnaik is here with us, and I'm very happy that sir has made out some time. And at the end of this session, sir, I'm sure you'll have some comments, so we'll wait for that.
Yes, I'm here to listen. I have some work also. I have to go.
No, you have to listen and you'll have to say something. So if you want to say it now, you can go ahead.
It will be after lunch also, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So I'll be there also. So don't let me speak on a topic which I'm not very familiar with. Okay.
I'm sure you can come up with something. So we'll wait for that. Over to you, Nikhil.
don't drag me into this. Please, I'm here to listen.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you, Chair, for this opportunity. And so my topic is transnational populism against immigrants, the altering path of EU values. The European Union is defined by its foundational core based on a free market, democratic freedom, equality, and the rule of law. The movement of goods, services, capital, and people, the four freedoms, form the basis of the entire European project. EU has integrated economically, institutionally, culturally, and even politically. The integration wave of late 20th century became a political force of unity, and the result was the Union. Similarly, today a new political force of unity and the result was today a new political wave is trying to transform the Union's fabric. The populist political narratives in domestic politics of member states are resonating in tandem with each other through European Parliament. The Eurozone crisis, the refugee crisis, and Brexit have shaped the last decade of European politics, infusing the Eurosceptic wave across the Union. Populist leaders and parties have appropriated xenophobic sentiments to intensify the anti-immigrant movement in their respective states. They have set their political agendas on identity and safeguarding their national culture. My paper argues that the populist forces of European Union are transnationally forming an anti-immigration narrative, a fundamental alteration to the EU values. The paper analyzes the anti-immigrant populist narratives in EU members and the rising popularity of populist narratives and its effects on the EU. I'll be presenting in two broad themes. First, I'll be talking about the populism in Europe and the transnational populism that's functioning. And second, how, if there is any alteration to EU value. So firstly, when we talk about populism and transnational populism, so globalization related changes to the system of trade, politics, and culture has transformed the party politics of the world. Creasy argues that the support for the extreme right and populism arise in part from a new cleavage caused by globalization. integration of the world perpetuated a simultaneous environment of protectionism. Hence, it became significant for us researchers to contemplate these ideas more thoroughly, and a lot of epistemic breeding of ideas took off on populism. One of the most essential places to study these ideas are the most integrated region, and that was Europe. But continuing this argument, Hugh and Marx also make this comment that the new globalization cleavage is reshaping European party systems and their politics. Support for the left has drained as working class voters, especially older generations, has shifted to extreme right. This growing influence of the extreme right has had effects on the entire system. For instance, when we see National Front in the French election of 2012 and 2017, the vote towards the right wing were based on negative feelings about EU's integrated responsibilities on the nation. The rise of populism, the radical right, are due to new cultural cleavages between those with traditional values against those holding new multicultural ones. The nativist emphasis on protecting cultural sanctity and heritage is essential to European populism. This is directly related to political extremism and xenophobia. The parties with nationalist and conservative cultural ideology have been vocal about multiculturalism and immigration. The characteristics of these populist parties have some features in common: a charismatic leader, political onslaught based on voters' feelings, appeal to popular insecurities, anxieties, or resentments. The populists have marked and promoted themselves as the true and rightful defenders of actual democracy. The principal notion of citizenship is based on the idea of homogeneous community. They espouse a political doctrine which is ideologically exclusionary in nature. The nation as a priority is at the core of the populace. The idea of nation as ethnic, historical, and any change in the fabric of the society is what the populists oppose. The idea of cultural nativism moved beyond xenophobia and seeking to detach themselves from any form of traditional racism is a popular political stance of populists across Europe. The populist cultural nativism aims at protecting its own indigenous in the sense of French identity, German identity, Norwegian society, culture, and way of life against what is seen as an alien intrusion, contamination, and subversion. When analyzing the radical right wing of Europe, it is the temptation of us researchers to ignore their question of their ideology. There are growing claims that populist parties remold the dynamics of European party competition and also to extend area of inquiry beyond areas of immigration and ethnic minorities. This is an obvious observation since these parties themselves have generally made little effort to ground their political propositions. They target the widespread anxieties, prejudices, and resentments and exploit such feelings for political gain. The voter sentiments derive them legitimacy, especially issues related to immigrants, foreigners, and refugees. Simultaneously, one can observe that their tendency in terms of major issues is associated with one that is anti-immigration. The European Conservatives and Reformist Group is a supranational right-wing body of which right-wing parties of mostly all the European Union nations are part of and fight elections under this banner to the European Parliament. In the pre-2015 era, the agenda of anti-immigration was not a transnational narrative. It was felt only by a few political parties in their respective states. The parties used to handle the issue of immigration in the context of labor market and unemployment. In principle, the anti-immigration was limited to its economic effects to the economy and the social security of the native population and high employment rates. Immigration was prevalent in this group, as stated in the officially party document. Effectively controlled immigration and an end to asylum procedures was what they demanded in the Prague Declaration in 2009. This transnational ECR group stated that EU's demographic problem is not going to be resolved with a non-restrictive immigration policy. The EU recognizes the threat of immigration at the supranational level, and the restrictiveness of the right-wing party confronts EU's functioning. The right-wing populists have increasingly moved along these exclusionary forces much before joining the European Union. The radical right has shifted from exclusionary populism to an ethno-cultural superiority and protecting of indigenous culture. The narratives across European Union and the rise of populism, which amalgamates into a transnational force at the European Parliament, have some distinct commonality. The emphasis in 1970s was on anti-communism because how the world was in the Cold War. It moved to an anti-immigration wave soon after 1980 onwards, when the demography started changing, leading to an anti-globalization and Euro-skeptic view in the first decade of the 21st century. When we see the parties like National Front of France, the Alternative for Deutschland, we see how they have increasingly have created a vote space in their own states. Like, for example, Marie Le Pen's vote share in 2017 increased to 21% and 33%. And then even in AfD in Germany, the Alternative for Germany, in its 5 years of establishment, has gained close to 94 seats in federal parliament and a vote share of 13%. Its key core principles being anti-Euro, anti-immigration, and anti-Islam. The Western European countries, the leading arbiters of European integration, have some of the oldest and most popular populist parties, like the Austrian FPÖ, Belgium's New Flemish Alliance, and the French and the German, as I mentioned. The East is more inclined to the cultural protection of the newly independent states and is robust in defending their sovereignty and their territoriality. The leading arbitrators here, as we have talked in the panel also, is Poland's PIS or even Hungary and Slovakian governments, which are formed by the right-wing populists. The right-wing is vociferous in expressing their conservative and protectionist politics, quoting immigrants as an invasion of foreigners, Germany for Germans, foreigners out, Poland's protests laden with banners of white Europe and chants of no to Islam, campaign posted in Slovakia by President Robert Fico protecting Slovakia against immigrants, and direct attacks of resistance and discriminatory practices propelled by the right-wing are a few instances to paint a larger picture.
4 minutes to conclude.
Oh, I will need extra. So these refugee crises of 2015 and Brexit have riled up the sentiments. The question of European integration is standing at the edge of its own precedented values. Now we move to the values of the European. The political institutionalism identified Europe as a political entity defining different institutions of modern politics, democracy, sovereignty, and others. Europe as a collective identity set the ground for Europeanness and the co-constitution of the European nation states. The European integration of the process that was political, economic, and social, along with some legal dimension. The delegation of power to a supranational institution under carefully controlled conditions is what the EU as an institute stands by. The European Union establishment is on fundamental of democracy. The manifestation of this core European value is the heart of Europe Union's Europeanization narrative. However, populism, which is seen as a threat to this core, it becomes an unequivocally not a good thing. Populism is regularly applied as a synonym for demagoguery, simplistic solutions, or opportunism. And especially in the vernacular sphere, the term is often used pejoratively to refer to vote-winning policy proposals, attempts to pander to public opinion, or xenophobic attitudes. Populism, as Abt and Ruman have argued, is inherently incompatible with democracy. And simultaneously, the narrative of Euroscepticism is in itself confusing. The institutional optimist or the historical European integration scholars have argued that the capacity of member governments to control supranational organs such as Commission and the European Court of Justice has declined and integration has become increasingly irreversible. So after Brexit, and do we see values being challenged by populism, do we see any disintegration or any larger change? And I will conclude with this. While the governments of sovereign member states remain free to tear up treaties and walk away at any time, the constantly increasing costs of exit in the densely integrated European polity have rendered this option virtually unthinkable. The institutional stronghold of EU and the complexity of independent economies has limited nation states' capabilities to break EU. However, the political narratives that run nation states and European Parliament are increasingly moving towards populism. The European values are institutionally strong and will remain to hold power. However, the political will with which EU was established is slowly losing its ground. The beliefs of democracy, a multicultural Europe, and the assimilation of nation states into a supranational structure is continuously challenged. The question of a European Union's future, which are the domestic politics of member states, are questioned, however, are not yet contested.
Your time is
just 30 seconds. The belief is more protectionist than disintegrating. The transnational force of populists is able to gather support and draw votes towards their victory. However, what they have not been able to challenge are the economic benefits of EU and continues to deliver this. Of course, the skeptics will talk about the Eurozone crisis, but the revival and sustenance is what EU as an institution tries to achieve. The Britain's exit and the refugee and the asylum policy failure post-2015 draw attention towards its limitations as supranational structure. However, as I said earlier, it is still not unable to challenge or contest the idea of EU. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikhil, for your nice presentation. Our next speaker is Yash Sharma. He's a research scholar at Center for European Studies and he'll be presenting on the refugee crisis and the rise of ethno-religious populism in Europe. So over to you, Yas.
Thank you, sir. So good morning, everyone. The two interlinked questions that my presentation and my paper seeks to address are, one, what is the ideological framework through which ethno-religious opposition to the entry of refugees in Europe is framed? And secondly, what were and what are the continuing manifestations of this opposition for European politics and society? So I'm going to be looking at four ideas within the through the course of my presentation. Firstly, what are the forms of opposition? What were the two forms of opposition that refusal to take in refugees adopted? Secondly, what is the broader theoretical principle of national populism that has become popular in Europe today? Thirdly, who is a European in the radical right imaginary? And fourthly, what are the manifestations of this that I'm going to be addressing through the concept of demographic nationalism on one end, and secondly, crimes of solidarity on the other? So firstly, what are the two forms of opposition? Now, it's important to understand that these oppositions are not necessarily binaries, but one form of opposition that we saw towards taking in refugees was from the principle of what is called welfare chauvinism or welfare nationalism, something that is much more popular in the wealthy Scandinavian countries, wherein the argument is through resource limitation, it's not like we don't want to take in refugees, but even if we want to, through because of resource limitations, we can't, and because we don't want our welfare systems to extend beyond our citizens as such. Therefore, it's not a normative opposition as such to the principle of taking in refugees. Whereas the second form of opposition, which is more an ideological opposition and will be the concern of this paper, is one where it is irrelevant whether we can or cannot. It is more that we don't want to take in refugees in the first place. And therefore, it is a more normative and ideological opposition to the broader principle or an obligation to take in refugees in the first place. Now, where does this rejection and this ideological opposition stem from? So I'll be using Brubaker's argument for the development of national populism in Europe today, which is linked to the principle of nativism, as other panelists like Nikhil and Lemmy have also pointed out before me. Now, Brubaker defines national populism as a polarized opposition between us and them in both horizontal and vertical dimensions. In terms of vertical dimensions, he talks about it's the difference between the people, the hardworking, honest people, and the corrupt elite, and the corrupt political, economic, or social elite. At the horizontal level, it's a distinction that is drawn between insiders and outsiders. Now, it's important to know that this distinction is based on the logic of insiders are one that share our way of life. So it's not just about territoriality, religion, or gender. It is about the broader principle of civilizational sharing that insiders do, and outsiders are those that threaten our way of life. Now, it's also important to know that it's not limited to individuals. It can also apply to institutions. So tomorrow, a basis through which Euroscepticism manifests in East European societies as different from West European societies is the idea that Europe as an institution at times attacks a way of life, something that was framed when they opposed the quota system. Now, what this leads to is the question of who is a European in the radical right imaginary stemming from this kind of ideological framework. It's important to understand that within this imaginary, Europeanness itself becomes a civilizational identity. It's not a religious identity, it's not a geographical identity. It now becomes a civilizational identity as such, wherein the difference is it's not about believing. It's not whether I believe in the Christian dictum and I believe I'm a Christian or I believe that I'm a European. It's a sense of belonging that you inherit by virtue of being born in a particular area within Europe as such. So you don't have to believe in it, you automatically belong to it. And when you belong to it, there are others who do not belong to it. And that's a distinction that gets framed and becomes the moral basis of the moral foundation of the social order. Therefore, the two tenets that I identify in the paper are one on one hand, religion, which is Christianity, on the second hand, which is race. So the white Christian becomes the us, and the them and the other becomes the non-white and the non-Christian. Now, how does this kind of ideological framework and this understanding of who is the European, who is a true European, manifest within European politics and society? On one hand is the rise of demographic nationalism. So demographic nationalism is framed as the irrational fear of demographic replacement of the us, which is the white European Christian identity. So one example of this are the bogus studies based on really questionable evidence that became really popular within the last decade, which was the idea that by 2050, Europe would turn into a Eurabia, which was about the threat of a civilizational loss. It's not just a demographic loss now. It's the loss of our entire civilization. It's the loss of our way of life. And we have to understand that this is an imagined threat. It's not based on concrete evidence, which is also evidenced by, as Limi said, or as we see in Hungary and East Europe, that refugees were using these areas merely as areas of transit and not areas of settlement. And yet these are the countries that increasingly frame this loss to our way of life, irrespective of whether these people are coming or not. Now that's significant, because what that means is that this fear can be used in perpetuity, because it's not grounded in actual evidence. And therefore, as and when sentiments have to be riled up, as and when elections come in, those irrational fears can be used and mobilized for, say, electoral gains. One way we can see this is through language. As Stanley Cohen argues in his concept of a moral panic button, metaphors of water, like flood of migrant, waves of migrant, or other pejorative terms like hordes, are used to denote the high numbers and imply that we automatically cannot cope with them, which does two things. One, it dehumanizes the individuals that are coming in. And secondly, decontextualizes the context from which they come from. Now, what also happens is that because there's a fear of civilizational loss, these leaders then turn this into a duty that others have to perform. One of the ways it happens is through the concept of state-sponsored nativism. Because now demographic loss is a fear, what can we do to counter it? There's a slew of legislation that came in, for example, in Hungary. I'll give you some examples. One was that no tax if you have 4+ children. You have state support to buy a car if you have 3+ children. You get favorable mortgage if you're a family. The fact that there's increased funding for daycares and kindergarten because female mobility is linked to lower fertility. These are just legislations wherein this kind of loss is framed as something that people have a duty to respond to. But what this also means is that if there's any criticism from Europe, as I outlined earlier, or European institutions, because there has been, it's framed as an attack on our way of life because of the earlier distinction that I drew within the populist radical right discourse. And this has a racial ethnic element because the fear is one of mongrelization or inbreeding. And they link this to the historical presence of the Ottoman rule and draw this kind of temporal link between Muslim invasions of those times and Muslim invasions through the hordes and waves of refugees coming in now. So demographic nationalism is one manifestation. Another manifestation is what is called crimes of solidarity. Now we have to understand that this is on one hand formal and legal sanction, but on the other hand, it's also an informal sanctioning of solidarity acts, which can be anything: assistance in the transit of refugees, volunteering to host refugees, or even coordinating material or monetary support and donations for refugees. Now, what the framework of crimes of solidarity is that there's a climate of ambiguity that is created within this particular society. And that climate is enhanced when you have authoritative governments. For example, in Hungary, wherein the kind of impunity that they enjoy in terms of arresting people or conducting cases against them because of the loss of judicial independence, that this form of ambiguity is enhanced. And I'll explain how. At one level is the formal legal sanctioning, which can be outright criminalization. So for example, if you're seen or if you're caught transporting a refugee from one point to another within a country or between two countries, you can be charged with smuggling. Now, it's ironical that when the state does it, when it transports hundreds of people...
Yes, you have 2 more minutes to
go. Yeah, I'll just wrap up within 2 minutes. That's okay. So it's ironical in that when the state transports thousands of refugees from one point to another without their consent, without caring for papers or not, that's not smuggling. But if you are seen to transport a particular individual, there's a fear that you would be charged with smuggling, or the fear of police harassment or arrest when you come to protest. So that's the formal legal sanctioning of all kinds of solidarity acts. But there's also a more pernicious, and which is where I think there's a link between what Nikhil spoke about earlier about the loss of values. So now what I look at is the loss that happens at the level of personal politics and domestic politics. So this loss of value happens when there's a sanctioning by informal networks like family, like friends, like kins, which stems from the earlier dehumanization of these people that I spoke about. So one of the surveys that I cite in my paper talks about how 36% of the people in Hungary feared retribution at their workplace if their political views came into light. 20% or one-fifth of them feared sanctions from friends. So this shows how the climate of fear and the climate of ambiguity with respect to punishment deters people. And so now, because the perceived risk and cost of participating and conducting acts of solidarity becomes so high, both at the formal level and more perniciously at the informal level, is how these acts are deterred. And in conclusion, this is the consequence and this is the manifestation where, if you allude to the earlier discussion yesterday, there was a debate about whether the refugee crisis has ended or not. I think these manifestations show that even if the first idea of whether refugees have stopped coming in or not has ended or not, these consequences and these long-term impact on informal politics, on broader societal level, are things that continue to become relevant, and which is why they continue to remain objects and subjects of discussion that we need to focus on. And with that, thank you.
Thank you, yes. So our presentations are over. Now the floor is open for discussion. If you have any specific question to any specific panelist, then you can just raise your hand or just pass it on the chat box. I see some questions in the chat box also. The first question is to Pooja. Goes by Sumbul Arvin. The question is, has the French government adopted any policy to increase employment and ameliorate living conditions of Muslims, immigrants, as social exclusion and unemployment have largely been responsible for the radicalization of Muslim immigrants in France?
Hello.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes, you are.
Sir, there is in three question in chat box regarding me. So yes, I would like to answer. I would like to answer the question of Surenda first regarding the French government response on Islamophobia to control Islamophobia. French government response. So according to me, if we seen in very recent, then according to Human Rights Watch in August 2020. The French government take decision to shut down anti-discrimination groups like CCIF. The full form of CCIF is Collective Against Islamophobia in France. Government take decision to shut down because it's threatened the basic human rights and liberties, including freedom of expression, association, religion, and rights, and principle of non-discrimination. So this is for Shunanda. And the first question raised by a person. For the first question, according to me, there is no one thing responsible for the Islamophobia. There are many factors. If we seen historically, then we can say Orientalism and racialization. Racialization is also cause of responsible for Islamophobia. And if we see it in contemporary era, then we can say xenophobia, ignorance of Islam, and internalization is also responsible for Islamophobia. And regarding the second part of the first question and regarding the third question raised by Sumbul Parveen, so I'm not aware of this question. So actually, I'm unable to answer because of the limitation of the studies that I did for this presentation. But really, it's a very good question, and I will focus on it after the meeting. And I need to study more on this area. Then I will be able to answer this question. If anybody in panel want to answer, then welcome on my side also. Thank you.
Any more questions to
Shakti? Can I just add on to what Shakti has said? I think the questions which were there regarding what kind of reaction and what kind of policies the government has taken to combat Islamophobia, some of it Pooja has pointed out. And I think it is also important to note that there are many, things which are being done more at the local level. So now this is something which has come up both not just in the case of France, but also across European cities, that different cities are looking at the question of integration from the perspective of each of these cities, and because they actually face the problem of different communities, diverse communities living together at in a more, real way. So in real terms, so there's a kind of a national policy, obviously, of integration. But how it is being implemented at the city level, there are much more studies being done on that. And also in the case of France, there are studies which show that different cities are trying to implement policies which may not be at odds with the one which is there at the national level, but they tailor make it according to their own requirements. So that is, I think, something which we need to focus on when we discuss points of integration, because normally our understanding and the vantage of our from where we look at these issues is how has the government or the national government taken up the policies, what kind of policies. So it's the state. The state is at different levels. So now I think it is also time for us to look at the various studies which are coming up of late, which are basically focused more on how people are actually living together. So lived experience of the people, how they are addressing questions of diversity, because they know that they have to live together, right? So the responses that they develop are much more practical solutions of how to deal with questions of you know, differences, cultural differences, religious differences. How do you, you know, you can't iron out everything, but there are ways in which you can adjust and compromise. So this is happening more at the local level, and I think we need to focus on that.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Any more questions to our panelists? You can just unmute yourself put the question.
So there's a question from Sudarshan, who has raised his hand. I will just unmute him.
Yes, please.
Sudarshan, please unmute yourself.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Sudarshan. I'm a research scholar from Mangalore University, student of Professor Jairaj Amin. Thank you for the opportunity to take part in this event. My question is for Limi. I just wanted to know why Poland is able to receive acknowledgement for a self-centered stand on the influx of the refugees, when it had its own population who had received shelter in many parts of the world.
Sudarshan, can you repeat your question once more?
Yeah. Why Poland is able to receive acknowledgement for a self-centered stand on the influx of refugees when its own population in the past had received shelter in many parts of the world, including India. So what is that kind of transition that has happened in Poland to come up with that kind of stand?
As in, why suddenly they have become very nativist about like only accepting certain kind of people when they have here. That's actually a question that has been asked a few many times. Thank you for your question first. To answer that, there could be several reasons for it. But like I started my paper with that, you know, Poland had a whole history of annexation and conquest across the past century. And Poland also has a significantly homogeneous population. And it's more used to adopting a stance in which they believe the idea of being Polish as being equal to the idea of being a good patriot, or the idea of being a Catholic Polish being the actual identity that is generally accepted throughout the country. It's not that they can't accept people from outside. Something that I think was missed in my presentation is the very fact, which Sir also ended up talking about, is how they will accept economic migrants or immigrants who are probably Christian. They don't have a problem with Christian Ukrainian migrants coming into the place, but they have a problem with anybody who even culturally looks a bit different, or culturally has different principles and values, which can stand against their religion, because religion means a lot to Poland. And that identity has been that identity has a history as it goes back to the point when Poland was formed in the first place. So it's not that, and also the fact that it's with, I think not only Poland, it's with any country for that matter. I think that hypocrisy exists, that we are always okay with our people going out, but we always have a problem with other people coming in, because our economy has to be responsible, or our culture and social fabric has to be responsible. So because my research was specifically on Poland, I tried to focus only on that. But I think this is something with many countries, as I think the ambassador yesterday also said the same thing, that any country tends to take up that stance in situations like these. So I think that is my answer. I hope I answered your question.
Thank you.
Any more questions? I mean, we can just have 2-3 minutes more.
Yeah. Hello.
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay. I'm Sunanda from SIS.
Yes. So my question is completely a general, anyone can question to this. My question is, how does EU states or EU perceive Christian refugees? Of course, Limi has answered a few seconds ago, but I want to know the general context, how they perceive. Does this perceive as a threat? Because mostly the immigration is the anti-immigration is related to Islam migration. So I would like to know about that. And the second one is, like, how are these Christian refugees integrated or assimilated to the white Christendom? Thank you.
Ansu? Ansu or yes, Nikhil?
Yes, sir. So basically, I was not able to understand the question properly. There was a little, I think, problem connection. She was saying, Nikhil, how you perceive?
Nikhil, did you get even, the question?
No, even I didn't hear.
Yeah, there was some glitch. Connection issue.
There was some glitch.
Sunanda, can you just repeat your question? I mean, precisely, you can just...
Or you can just write it in the chat box, perhaps?
Yeah, that'll be...
So sorry. So how does the EU stay? Oh, yeah.
And there's a big glitch.
Yeah.
I can't hear it.
Sunanda, just leave your question in the chat box too quickly. You don't have much time left.
We have another question in the chat box, sir.
Yes, meanwhile, you can just...
So the question is to everyone, whether realist view is going to succeed, national interest versus integration.
I can answer this question. The integration has succeeded, whoever has asked this question. EU is an integrated body, like it's a supranational integrated body, and it has already succeeded. They have moved beyond a very realist kind of way, and like they've gone to institutionalism and the member states coming down to institutionalism. It's a kind of a liberalism. If you see it theoretically, probably it's a liberalist idea. So yeah, it has succeeded. It's running since 30 years, more than 30 years, and I don't think that realist. Yeah, there are national interests which are, as I said in my presentation, it is being. It's not like the EU's sanctity is not contested. It is obviously questioned or like talked about, but it's not contested as for now. So I think integration has won, if that is the question.
Okay, Sunanda, she just left the question. How does the EU or member states perceive Christian refugees? Secondly, how are they integrated or assimilated to the European Christian society? Are they integrated?
Okay, just I can add on to what Nikhil said, and maybe then you can take the question.
Yeah.
Because I think Nikhil was saying that, the integration is on, it's something which is a given now. And in his when he was presenting also, he had mentioned about the high cost of actually an exit. And that is something which is very evident when we see how messy the whole, Brexit issue has been. And in the context of Central and Eastern Europe, especially most of the papers were related to that. And though they were talking about Euroscepticism, I think we also need to understand it's more so far as the political parties and the leaders are concerned in the when they negotiate at the European Union level that they appear, they use that Euroscepticism. But if you look at the larger public, if you look at the support of the people for the EU, that is pretty much intact. So there is on the one level, parties which are Eurosceptic, which are being elected by the people, but they are also reassured that they are within the European Union project and the European Union integration, very much part of the European Union integration. So I think we also need to keep that in mind when we are discussing Euroscepticism of these countries. Because they have really benefited a lot from EU through the different funds that they have got. Okay, I'll not take any more time. I'm just flagging off issues for you to discuss and maybe carry forward. Okay,
Looking at Sunanda's question, how does the EU or member state perceive Christian refugees? Now, first look at it that EU does not look at Christian refugees. But EU refugees are refugees. So now member states come into play. So see, I have not done much work on the Central European countries, but a little bit of knowledge of history that I have is that Eastern Europe does not have a history of colonialism. So for them, then migration becomes a very different aspect. Now, since they've never had these kind of migrants, they, for them, integrating them and then accepting them becomes a little difficult. Now, Spain, if you look at Spain, Spain has a colonial history. I mean, they colonized so many Latin American countries. So now they feel that they have that kind of responsibility to take them in and integrate them because it was a part of their empire in the past. So that is one aspect. So then Central Europe and then Spain becomes a little different. And when you're talking about integration of Christian or non-Christian people, we need to look at it that integration of immigrants as such is dependent on who you are. Christian and non-Christian, of course, it's important. If you look at it from, I mean, if you look at it in, Russia or maybe that Crimea incident that happened, then, I mean, those Russians are also Christians, but they're facing problems. There are other things also related to that. I mean, they say that their sovereignty is different, that they're Russians, ethnic Russians, women, there are other issues. But if we say that only the idea of religion is important in integration, we are missing other points. I mean, there are other things like access to labor market, education, and how the destination country perceives you. And it's not important that, I mean, if you look at Romanians in Spain, for that matter of fact, they also have integration issues, even though Romanians are basically Christians. So how the Spaniards, many of them who discriminate them, see them as second-class citizens just because they're from Central Europe. So, I mean, it's not about the religion itself. It's also about how you're perceived globally as well. Because you looked at second-class citizens being not from Northern or Southern Europe, but from Central Eastern Europe. So there's a little status which has gone down just because of where you come from, geographically differentiated. And also that, I mean, you come there to do menial jobs. Just like I think yesterday's presentation, somebody has said dangerous, distraught, and really lowly jobs. And that also makes your position really low. Now, if somebody who's going there to do some really high technological job or like whatever, like maybe as a professor, they will have a very different, people will have a very different perspective of them. At that point of time, the religion will not matter. I mean, you have professors or you have mayors in London who are like at a very big position. So they're not going to face discrimination. So that's it.
Okay, thank you, Ansu. With this, we come to the end of this session. Congratulations to all the paper presenters. They have really presented good papers. And thank you all for participating in this discussion. We will carry forward this meeting. Maybe after 10 minutes break, we will have another session. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir. Thanks to all the presenters for their splendid papers. As sir said, we do have a few minutes break and you can keep yourselves logged in for the next session, which will start at 11:40 sharp. Thank you.